Okay, welcome everybody. My talk is probably the most low level that we have heard like in this week and seen in demos. I'm talking about how we can plan motions, design the control, and use learning to improve the performance of these vehicles. And I have two scenarios, slalom racing and flight dances, which should just demonstrate where the challenges are and what we can do by now. So just for my background, I'm really a control engineer. So in my master's research at the University of Stuttgart and at the Georgia Institute of Technology in the US, I basically did mathematics on very abstract systems and did proofs on stability and designed optimal control. And then for my PhD, I wanted to change direction and actually see these algorithms in action. So that's kind of how I got into robotics. So I did my PhD with Professor Raffaello D'Andrea and finished last summer, and now I'm in Toronto since January. But you can imagine, since January, I couldn't do much research. So most of the things I'm showing are actually results of my PhD. So my research is really at the interface of robotics, controls, dynamics, and learning. And I view these as really important building blocks in the end for a much, much bigger puzzle to develop autonomous and intelligent systems. So it's just a little small part, a niche, but we need all these parts at the end to come together to build truly autonomous systems. So the work I'm focusing on today is on planning and the precise execution of agile multiple or single vehicle motions. So what I mean by agile is what we have seen this week is very slow waypoint following. So we really explore the dynamic range of quadrocopter vehicles and see where the challenges are and what we can achieve. So if you consider the planning and the execution, it kind of touches all these areas. So first we need to know which motions are actually doable by a quadrocopter, and for that we look at the physical model of the vehicle. And then if we have multiple vehicles, we have to find ways to design motions that are collision-free. And once we know what we can do, we need a control that actually guides the vehicle along these desired paths. And in the end, and probably the most researchy part is, can we improve the performance of the vehicles if we use past data to understand the system and the environment even better? And everything is demonstrated on quadrocopter platforms, but in general, the approaches transfer to any other dynamic system. So what I want to do is give you a quick background on our experimental setup, because it's quite different to what most of the people have here. Then give you an idea how we use models to approach the problem of planning, control, and learning. And then show you the two scenarios, slalom racing and flight dances, and then conclude with a summary and outlook. So our experimental setup is actually indoors. So to make our life a little bit easier. It's behind this glass wall, and it is called the Flying Machine Arena. And what is going on behind is we fly small quadrocopters autonomously, guided by the computers that are off-board and can do things like this. So the general setup is we have an external camera system at the ceiling that helps us a lot. Basically, it provides very precise position information with 200 hertz and also the attitude of the vehicle. So you can compare it. It's what GPS does for you outside, but it's much more frequent and much more precise. And this information goes to a computer that usually is centralized, so one computer that guides all the vehicles. And this computer computes pretty low-level commands to the vehicle, the collective thrust, so the force that all four propellers produce together, and the turn rates around the three axes, main axis of the quadrocopter. And by doing this interface at a low level, we have most of the computation here, which is not a the reason is not that it's a lot of computation, it's more that we can do fast prototyping. On board the vehicle, we use the rate gyros as feedback to follow these desired commands. And the standard way we operate it is similar to what you do if you do GPS waypoint following, is we define desired vehicle position and heading, so four desired values for four independent actuators that we have. So this fully defines the motion of the quadrocopter. So we specify the desired position trajectory and the heading and have a control algorithm that tries to follow this as precisely as possible. So this is the standard setup. It is very simplified. I mean, we reduce our problem quite narrowly to the controls. A big part of flying autonomously outside is the state estimation of the quadrocopter vehicles. We basically avoid this, but focus on the control and see how well we can do in the best case. We know that if we go outside, it will be worse because we have more noise on the measurement, on the position estimate and attitude. So in this setup, we use a model-based approach to plan trajectories, design the controller, and in the end use learning. And what I mean by model-based approach is we use a very simple physical model, a first principles model, and you don't necessarily need to understand the equations, but it's basically two equations, one for the translational dynamics, so how the position of the vehicle changes over time depending on the input, and one set of equations for the rotational dynamics. So this is what I mean when I talk about model. We don't model any aerodynamic effects. And very important, if we want to know what such a vehicle is capable to do, is we need to know the constraints of the actuators. And here we separate it. It's basically the force that each of the propellers can produce. And usually this is the minimum is larger than zero. And then we have sensor constraints because our gyroscopes usually don't can only measure turn rates up to a certain limit. And if we go above the control, we can't really control anymore because we don't know precise values for the turn rates. So this is the basic model that we are using. It's pretty straightforward. It doesn't need lots of system identification. And whenever this is not enough, our approach or philosophy is to use learning. So the model tells us a few things. So it tells us roughly what is possible with these vehicles. Also, it tells us what is easy and what is difficult. For the controller design, it's essential because we design the controller for the nominal model that I just showed you, such that in the nominal case, the desired position equals the measured position. So we design a controller such that whatever we want to achieve, we input, and ideally the vehicle would exactly follow this trajectory. So we do this based on this model, and then we also use it in the learning, as you will see later. In the learning, it tells us in which direction we must correct if we see errors. So this is the basic setup. we use this model in the planning step, in the control, and in the learning. And now I show you two different examples where you use different planning and learning steps, but see like significant improvements through the learning. So the slalom racing, the idea is simple. We want to find a trajectory through these poles that is time optimized. And to do so, since the dynamics are nonlinear, it's not necessarily trivial to find the optimal path. So we do a nonlinear optimization that kind of finds the velocity that is feasible given our sensor and actuator limits. This will not find the global minimum necessarily, but you can tweak it. So already this is quite difficult to find a time-optimized trajectory through an arbitrary set of poles. But let's assume we have found this. Here I put it in the vertical plane, just instead of the horizontal, such that it's easier to understand what's going on. So we have this desired trajectory that we want to follow. And the first step we do is, because our controls we have defined such that in the ideal case, desired position should be equal to measured position, we just input the desired trajectory and see what we get. And what we get is the following. So I have to say, you can probably do better, but this control is not tuned for any specific motion. So what you see here is a couple of trials of the same motion, and you observe a large repetitive error. This is good in a sense that it is something that is repeatable, and repeatable things you should be able to learn. So the reason why we see this is the main reason is that our model doesn't hold anymore. Like, we made assumptions on how much thrust each propeller produces for a given turn rate, and this doesn't hold if you fly fast. And it's very complex, and not all the effects are even understood that are going on if you fly fast with these vehicles. So the best thing is to do a general approach and instead of try to learn a model, try to learn a general error vector. So what we do is we do repetitive experiments. So always collect input and output data from all the experiments and update the input trajectory that we sent to the stabilized system. And the advantage of this is that in this case, because you do it in a repetitive fashion, you can actually predict disturbances in the future and correct before they really affect the system. So it can really have a much better effect than just feedback control. So in more detail, I don't show the equations, but in more detail it's basically relatively simple. We estimate a disturbance along the whole trajectory. So for each point along the trajectory, we allow an additive disturbance that we don't know initially, but that we can estimate from the input-output pairs that we get from our repetitive trials. And once we have this disturbance estimate, we use our simple model to tell us in which direction we must correct. So you can imagine if you throw a basketball and you don't throw strong enough, then the ball doesn't reach the basket. But you, as a human, have this knowledge that next time you just have to push harder. You just know the direction in which you have to correct, and you try again. And you can basically, the concept is the same here. We use this simple model to try to update our input in the right direction. And this update is done with a convex optimization, so it's quite fast. So this overall step of updating the input takes, depending on the length of the trajectory, two, to do 5 seconds and could probably be reduced as well. So this is the basic setup. And if we look at the results, this iteration zero is what we saw before, the multiple trials in red. And then we quite quickly converge to the desired S trajectory. And then after 2 iterations, so you see here 5 to 10, it has basically converged. And the small variations that you still see are due to errors that are not repetitive. So errors in the initial condition that vary from trial to trial. But it's still a significant improvement from the beginning. So we thought of ideas how to visualize this in a demonstration. So the slalom was the result for that. So we first did the learning research and then came up with a slalom idea. So the, oh, that's kind of what's going on. Sorry, I forgot about this. So this is the input y position. The blue one is what the nominal model would have said. And then the gray one is the converged input, which what you see is these tips are earlier and with a larger magnitude. So now the video. So here, a master student of mine just puts up the pose in arbitrary position, and the system calculates the optimal trajectory around it and the vehicle practice above the sticks until it knows that it can make it, and then it dies down. So basically, after each iteration, it updates the input that is sent to the vehicle. And because we use so much prior information, this process is quite quick. Yeah, and this is the result. So the video shows now some other configurations and the learned, just the learned results, to kind of also show you to what kind of motion we can push these vehicles.
Do you relearn for a new configuration?
Yeah, we relearn. Yeah, but there are some results now. There are some results. So this is now for the GoPro version, just to show you again. And that's goodness. Study should show that from past experience we can learn and we can improve the performance, and by using model information as prior information we can converge quite quickly. So the second experiment is a little bit different. Before I explain much, I quickly show you a 10-second video. I think that says more than my voice. So this was a nice project because we knew where we wanted to go, and we just could solve each of the problems we encountered. But it was chosen because to be expressive, we need motion primitives that are parameterized, and ideally these are also challenging motions, and relearning each of these parameterized and periodic motions periodic, because that's kind of the most natural way to move to the music, it's very cumbersome. So we tried to find, studied some ways if we can reduce our learning load. So the first thing we looked at is if we have a parameterized motion where we have the amplitude of such a side-to-side motion and the frequency, what can we actually do using just looking at the dynamics of the model? And by looking at this, we can exclude a lot of motions that are not doable. And these are basically, if I have a high frequency, I can only do very small amplitudes to not have too large thrust values that my motors cannot produce anymore. So basically, only this wide part is actually feasible just from the simple model. And then if we apply such a side-to-side motion here over time, the x coordinate, and the blue line is the desired line, and the gray is what we get from our normal feedback controller, we see that we have an amplitude and a phase error. Phase error means we are not precisely in the rhythm of the music, but it's almost, not everyone can see it, actually, but the amplitude is significant. And what we do here is to correct this motion, we only correct two parameters, is an amplitude correction and a phase correction. And what we also found, this correction factors are only depending on the frequency and not on the amplitude. So basically, by learning the correction factor for this motion, we can do any motion with this frequency and any other amplitude. And this holds even in three dimensions, so each direction, x, y, and z, are independent, and we only need to learn in each direction the frequencies that are actually in the music. So we can do a set of identification runs before a performance, and that's kind of like practicing for artists. This takes around 10 to 50 minutes, depending on how many different frequencies we want to test. And then we can fly very precisely any periodic motion. Another challenge here was that we need to fly multiple vehicles at the same time. And I have to say, whenever they do periodic motions, they are programmed individually, and we make sure that they don't collide. But between, like, to transition from one periodic motion primitive to another, these transition motions are very cumbersome to program. So basically, what we looked at is how we can transition multiple vehicles sitting somewhere in the space to another configuration sitting somewhere else. And we did this using convex optimization, again our simple model of the system, and the goal here was just having smooth motion, so we minimize the energy. And this is just the result. So here they go from one configuration to another, minimizing their energy and keeping always a certain distance between each other. So these are pre-programmed configurations here. But this, and here they are just random, so they go from this configuration to this, autonomously deciding how they go proceed. But centralized. It's all centralized with our centralized off-board computer. So putting all this together shows you what is currently possible with multiple of these vehicles having an indoor space. So as a summary, what we tried to study is how well can we control these vehicles once we know which motions are actually feasible. And we saw that even if we don't basically have precise position information, if we want to fly highly dynamic motions, it's quite difficult even in this, this idealized like environment. But like the good thing is that controls and learning, especially learning, can enable some of the behaviors that are really difficult to achieve otherwise, maybe only because if you do really precise modeling. So we can almost go to the limits of the vehicle using learning techniques. So now this was very abstract, I would say, compared to some of the application scenarios we were discussing. So since January, I was also talking to people in Toronto to see what their problems are and where they are currently. So I want to give you a quick update on like the company side and some of the ideas we have to apply this to real vehicles. The most of them are ideas. So the first one is Precision Hog. It's a startup company that does this fixed wing vehicle. They already sell it to farmers there for precision agriculture. So it's very popular. Basically what they do is they select an area that they want to observe, and then they fly these survey lines and take pictures along the lines. And in the end, all the pictures are actually uploaded and stitched together, and then the farmer gets the information that he wants. So the big problem they have is that if they have wind, they align these survey lines accordingly that the wind is either coming from this side or from the opposite side, but still it has such a big effect on this fixed wing vehicle that the turns are really bad. And this reduces the amount of area that you can cover because you lose a lot of energy to just do this turn that basically doesn't bring you any information. So the idea is that from the first turn you learn about the wind and the effects on the vehicle for the next turn already, and after 3-4 turns you may already be almost converged or learned enough to save energy again. So this is just an idea, but there are different challenges that are not addressed, but basically basically it could be solved with our technique. And even these values could be stored and reused later if a different similar condition occurs again. Then there is Aerion. They are also a little bit older startup. They do quadrocopter vehicles. They cannot sell it to the US, so they only sell it to the Middle East right now. They have a nice interface, and altogether, I think they said it costs $100,000, so it's not cheap. So what they did is they can fly in up to 60 miles per hour wind, which is really good. They achieve this by precisely modeling the effects of the wind on the vehicle. That has worked so far, but now the people want to exchange the payload there. So basically they would need to do this big effort of modeling for each different payload. And ideally they would just have an open like interface so people could put whatever they want. So now they also have this idea that they online learn or adapt to the payload they attach. And then the last one is a nice one. MDA is a space robotics company. Most of the robots in space, they are still teleoperated. This is fine, but you're really slow. What you could do is, once you have teleoperated once, you can use this information, also the images you collect and the map you can build along this path, to do this path in a repetitive fashion. That sometimes they want to do this to take measurements. And by learning, you can actually, that's what he showed, increase the speed over time. So through learning, you can at some point drive much, much faster autonomously than the teleoperated person could have done. So these are just some of the ideas. And just to give you an idea, that's kind of where I spent most of my time. The institute is a little bit outside of the city. It's nice because it has a large, like the blue area is all outdoor space that belongs to the property. So it's easier to fly there. And then there's also a large dome that was used as a Mars simulation environment, but looks like this and is like 50 meters in diameter, so lots of space without wind for first testing. Okay, thanks.